So, doing the, Creature of the Black Lagoon is not only a cult classic, but it's a legendary movie. It's part of that Universal Monster series that was back in the 50s and 60s. Specifically with Creature from the Black Lagoon, I would say a good 40% of that movie was, 30 to 40% was filmed underwater, which back then was a very, very kind of new thing. What was that process like doing that in a time where technology was a lot different than it is today?
Well, we didn't have scuba gear at the beginning of that show. I used an air hose, and I'd breathe from it, and then hold my breath and go in and do the scene. And I had a signal with my safety people that if I went totally limp, that meant I needed air. I'd go totally limp, and they'd bring me more air hose. Breathing from the air hose is kind of like if you're in your backyard and you got a hose of water and you want to drink some of it, you just drink whatever you want, let the rest spill out. It's the same thing with breathing air from an air hose. And the funny thing though, when I was breathing from the air hose, the bubbles would go up in the top of my head. And just before we begin a scene, the cameraman would give me a roll. I would press down on top of the head to get the bubbles out. But if you watch the movie, you'll still see some bubbles coming out of the top of the head. They shot with 3D cameras, and that was two cameras side by side. Yeah. And Scotty Welburn, the cameraman, built the housing to hold the two cameras. And it got flooded twice during the filming. And so they had to overnight readjust the cameras and the housing in order to film the next day. And they did a good job, and we did film the next day.
And they were big, heavy cameras.
Yeah, how big were cameras like that?
I'd say like, I pulled my hands up by like this.
Did it take multiple people to hold it, or was it just kind of a shoulder harness?
The cameraman would hand hold it.
Okay.
But he had an assistant with him in order to adjust focusing.
Very cool. At the time that you're filming and working on this movie, did you have any idea at the time that it would become what it's become?
Not at all. We made the movie. I went to the movie, but I had to pay to get in. Ocala, Florida. I enjoyed the movie, and I thought we did a pretty good job. Well, I didn't hear anything until about 20 years later. I got a letter, somebody wanted a picture. Well, I didn't have any picture. And so finally, a fan sent me a picture, and I had it duplicated, and I started sending out this one picture. And now I've got like 300 pictures, and I get them from different people, and I have them reprinted, and put them at our table and sell them.
Very cool. So you actually, outside of Creature of the Black Lagoon, you ended up doing kind of the marine coordinating for a lot of movies in the years to come, things like Flipper. You were very involved in that. Things like Caddyshack. I mean, when you were done with Creature of the Black Lagoon, did you realize that your career was going to be as successful, or did you know that that's the direction you wanted to go with your career?
No, not at all. But yes, I did want to make it a career, and I began directing, which I did a lot more of than I did acting. I directed the underwater scenes for Thunderball. And Never Say Never Again on James Bond film. And I worked on Around the World Under the Sea with Ivan Tors and a TV series called Sea Hunt. And I did all the second unit work on Caddyshack and many other things. I forget, my daughter knows.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a lot. Yeah. And he was the one who got the idea for Flipper,
mm-hmm.
and wrote it.
Yeah, do you want to talk a little bit about working with the animals and what that process was like and what that experience was like?
Well, yes, I was, my children were at home watching a TV show called Lassie, and I had been somewhere working on a project, and I came home and sat down with them, and as they were watching Lassie, I remembered when I was in high school that I saw a Greek coin with a man riding a dolphin. I thought, my golly, why not make a movie about a boy and a dolphin? And I got all excited. My brother-in-law was a radio announcer and a good writer, and I wasn't a very good writer, but I had a lot of ideas. So he and I wrote a book called Flipper, and I took it to New York with my last $200 and tried to sell it to some book companies. And I got one company seemed very interested. So I came back home and I never heard from him. Well, I had worked on a TV show with Ivan Tors, and he was a producer in California. So I called Ivan on the phone. I said, Ivan, I got a book that we wrote about a boy and a dolphin. Can I say you're considering it as a movie? So I can get the book company more interested in publishing it. He said, yeah, okay, send me a copy. So I sent him a copy, but in the meantime, called the book company and I said, I got a producer in California who wants to make this into a movie, hoping that that would get them more incentive to make the book. But I never heard from them. I did get a call from Ivan, and Ivan said, I received your little book, and I didn't read it, but my wife did. And she made me read it. I loved it. Let's make a movie. So they got the money from MGM. Made the first Flipper feature. Finding the animal was the most difficult part. We went to various aquariums in California and in Florida and in Atlanta, Georgia, and we couldn't find anybody that had dolphins that were swimming with people. And we asked them if we could use a dolphin for our show, and they all turned us down. But we were driving into Florida Keys to see some animals. And we stopped by a place where a guy named Milton Santini had a dolphin in a pond near his home. And he said he kept this dolphin there to bring wild dolphins in, because he sold wild dolphins to aquariums. He said, I'd bring the wild dolphins in, they would see my dolphin eating, and they would eat sooner, cut fish. So he said, go take a look at her. So we went over, and the animal's name was Mitzi. And we had a little dock going out, and Ivan walked out on the dock, and I waded out in the water about waist deep. And just as I got out in the water about waist deep, Mitzi, this porpoise, swam around and stuck his nose right up under my arm. I looked at Ivan, and I said, we got that. So I spent the next, 3 months training the dolphin to do various tricks that we needed for the movie. But I'd never trained a dolphin before, so it trained me as I trained it. And I had my son with me, who was the age of the boy that's going to be in the movie. And he wore a pair of cut-off jeans. And I had trained the dolphin to retrieve things such as a rag, tennis balls, and whatever. And I got a bright idea, why not let her retrieve the boy? So I said, Ricky, when I throw my arm like I'm throwing a ball, you jump in the water and see if the dolphin will bring you back. So sure enough, he jumped in the water, the dolphin went over there, and the dolphin grabbed one of the little loops on his pants and started to pull him. And he accidentally stuck his hand up in the air. The dorsal fin went right into his hand, and she swam right to me. Oh. Well, I said, wow. So I said, Ricky, you go across the canal, which was about the distance from here to that door. And I said, I'm going to throw the ball over your head. You jump in the water and see if the dolphin won't bring you to me. So I threw the ball, and he jumped in the water. She swam over there, he held the dolphin fin, and she swam right to me. So I knew we really had Flipper. I spent the next 3 months working with Flipper and the boy to get all of the things we needed for the scenes in the picture, and it worked out very well.
Wow. Very neat. So most of us, when we get in the water, we're like, you know, flopping around, and we don't really know what to do in the water. How is it, how do you prepare yourself to go in and film these scenes and, I mean, spend a large amount of time underwater?
Well, I've done an awful lot of work underwater prior to making the movie. I was a lifeguard at Wakulla Springs near Tallahassee, Florida. And the gentleman who owned the hotel also taught us how to swim with an air hose. And so he called me one day and he said, "Ricou, I've got some people from California coming in. Could you pick them up at the airport and take them to the springs and show them around?" He said, "I got to be out of town." I said, "Okay." So I went to the airport, I picked up these three gentlemen, took them to the springs and showed them around. And they loved the springs, they loved the river, and they loved everything about it. And the cameraman said to me, he said, "Would you mind swimming in front of the camera so I could get some perspective of the size of a human being to the fish and to the eels and to the grass and so forth?" I said, "Sure," so I did. About 2 weeks later, I get a call from the manager who had come back already. He said, "I got a call from the people from California and they want to talk to you." I gave him your phone number. I said, "Okay." So I got a call from Jack Arnold, who turned out to be the director of the film. He said, "Ricou, we like the way you swim. How would you like to be an underwater monster?" I said, "Why not?" So I went to California and spent about 3 months there. But about a month out of that 3 months, they built a suit. In the first suit, you look more like a lizard than a creature or anything else. No one liked it. They started over to rebuild the suit. And they had a gentleman come from Disney World, Chris Mueller, who was a molder and a model maker. And the gentleman named Jack Kevan, who worked at the studio at Universal, created the new suit. And the new suit they loved, I loved it, and I could swim in it easily. And so that was the suit we used in the movie.
Talk about the vision.
Vision was the worst part of the suit. I was going to wear a face mask underneath the suit, but it stuck out too far, so we eliminated that. Then we went to goggles. Well, they were fine, but when they filled with water, I had no way to get rid of the water. So I went with my naked eye. I sat about 2 inches away from my eye, and so the vision was the poorest part of you doing the film. I could see, like this gentleman in the first row there, I could see there was a human being, but I wouldn't know necessarily who he was. And the cameraman would give me a roll with his arm, little big circles, which I could see, and said, "Get ready to do the scene." And then I'd hold my breath as long as I could and do the scene. But prior to going into the scene, I would breathe from the air hose. Air would go up into the head and bubbles would come out of the top of the head. So just before I'd go into any scene, I'd press down on top of the head to get rid of all the bubbles. But if you watch the movie, you'll see bubbles still coming out of the top of the head.
When you're filming those scenes, how long did they have you underwater during that? I mean, was it just a couple minutes? Did they have you under there for a while, or?
Well, we would swim all day, in and out of the water, and it was cold. The water temperature was 71 degrees, and at that time, the air temperature was 49. So it got pretty chilly if you were out in it all day. I would go underwater, and the water was warmer, actually, than the air. So I was pretty warm. warm underwater, but when I came out of the water onto the barge to rehearse the next scene, I was really cold. And the crew started feeling sorry for me. So one of them would come up and say, how do you like a little shot of brandy? Well, each one didn't know the other.
Oh, no.
Pretty soon they had a drunk preacher. They had to cut that out.
What was the hardest part about filming those underwater scenes? I know you had mentioned the vision was pretty difficult. Was the suit pretty lunky and kind of hard to swim in, or was it pretty easy to swim in?
Well, to begin with, it was kind of like swimming with a raincoat on or something. But I got used to it. I guess the best way to put it is like when you're in high school and you're going to play football, you put on the uniform with the pads and everything. It's kind of awkward, but when you get in the game, you don't even know you have this, you know, the air on. It was the same with my suit. I get underwater and swim, and I just forget I was in a suit and do the best I could to get the scene done.
Tell me about weights and everything. You have to wear the weights.
Oh, the suit was made of sponge rubber and latex, and so I couldn't sink in it. So I had to wear lead weights in order to go down. And I had a lead chest plate, lead thigh pads, lead around my ankles, and I was able to sink and get neutrally buoyant underwater. And that was fine, but when I came out of the water, the suit was full of water, the lead was heavy, so it was real heavy when I came out.
Do you have a favorite memory from working on that movie, something that just kind of stands out to you?
Oh, I had to, every now and then we would be out on this barge in the middle of the spring all day long, and every now and then I had to go to the bathroom. So they would put me in a boat, row it ashore, and I'd go up to the hotel, go to the bathroom. Well, they started saying, get in the boat. I said, no, I'll just swim in. So I took the head off and the hands off, and I swam into the dock. And as I was climbing out of the water, this woman had her little girl with her, and they were walking out to where I was coming out. And when I came out of the water, the little girl started screaming and running. And the mother turned around and came back to me and said, don't you ever scare my child again. Anyway.
So, being in a suit like that, doing that, acting in a role that really doesn't have very many or any speaking lines, is there a different way that you prepare for a role like that versus a role where you, I mean, obviously having to memorize lines, but I mean, still having to perform in a way that is believable without being able to speak. Is that difficult at all?
No, I found it pretty easy. And the reason being, as I said, the way the creature swam in the movie is where I, the same way I normally swim. So I didn't have to learn anything. And so I just came kind of easily, and it worked out very well.
Awesome. Outside of Creature of the Black Lagoon, what's one of your favorite projects that you ever worked on?
I think the James Bond movie, Thunderball. I directed the underwater sequences for that show. And the great thing about it was I didn't have a budget. I spent all the money I wanted to do a good job. And that's very rare in the film business. They try to rush you and force you to stick to a schedule. Well, I didn't have any schedule, I didn't have to stick to anything, but just do a good job, and I could spend all the money I wanted. And that's one of the first times I've ever had that happen. I don't think too many people in any film business has that happen, so I enjoyed that.
Awesome.
Oh, I did a show called Salty. It was about a sea lion and a little boy. And I had to get a sea lion to play the part in the movie. And so I called California and I talked to some animal guy and I said, can I get a sea lion? He says, yeah, I'll mail you one. I said, you'll mail me one? He says, yeah, I will put aboard the airplane and they'll bring it to you. So I bought a sea lion and they flew it in and it was in a cage and I took it to my house and the sea lion was still nursing on a bottle.
Oh.
So I had to give it a bottle to drink in order to get it to get large enough to eat fish. And I had a little Mustang car and the sea lion would sit in my lap and I'd give it a pacifier in its mouth. So I'd be going down the road with the sea lion sticking his head out the window with a pacifier in his mouth. People thought I was nuts. Anyway, the sea lion was a wonderful animal. My son had just gone to the Marine Corps, so we used his room at my home for the sea lion to stay. And she would sleep on the bed, and we had a tray underneath the bed. We pull the tray out at night. The sea lion, when she had to go to the bathroom, would just throw her tail over to the side, go to the bathroom in the tray, and go back on the bed. Very clean animal. Well, we had a shower that she used to go into in his bedroom. And she'd go in the shower and sit under the water, and she loved it. But something we didn't think about, she sat on the drain. And so when the water kept coming, she stopped the water from flowing, so the water overflowed in the bathroom, into the bedroom, into this long hallway we had. And I was sitting in the living room and I saw this water coming in. And I said, what in the world is that? Well, Salty comes out and swims and slides all the way from the bedroom to the living room into where I was.
Oh, man.
So we had to stop putting her over in the bathroom, over the
we had a pool too.
Yeah, we had a swimming pool and she loved to swim in the swimming pool. Mm-hmm. And they're wonderful animals. And I tried to always have the animal if I was doing an animal show at my home before I do the movie to make sure the animal could do everything we need in the movie. I had otters and I trained two different otters and I was going to do a show with them. Then a movie came out called Bright Water or something like that. They used otters, so I scrapped that show. One funny thing was my daughter had a pet frog, and she put him out on the porch on a ping pong table, and he stayed out there pretty much. Well, one of the otters got loose and ate the frog, and my daughter was broken hearted.
Wonderful. Well, all these people are here to talk to you, and so I think we'll open it up to some questions now. I might be able to get this mic out here. We've got a mic stand over here. If anybody wants to come up, we can make a little bit of a line and people can ask some questions. Does anybody have any questions? At the time you were doing Flipper, how much was known about training animals like dolphins and otters and sea lions and things like that? Did you have to figure out a lot of things yourself, or were there people you could talk to that taught you how to train an animal?
At the time, back during when that was being filmed, how much was known about training animals? Did you have to do research into that, or was it just kind of a trial and error thing?
No, training animals, such as a sea lion, I didn't know anybody that had trained one to work with people. And so I had to start from scratch, me training it and it training me, so that we could figure out what to do for the movie. And the same thing with dolphins. I had never trained a dolphin before, but when I had to do it for the movie,
back then when they trained dolphins, the dolphin was in the water and they'd jump out of the water and they, you know, do tricks out of the water, but they didn't have a relationship with people. And so that flipper started that, you know, where the actual people would be in the water with it. And nowadays you see, you know, people in the water with whales and dolphins and sea lions. And flipper pretty much started that. Mm.
Very cool. Thanks for the question.
Hi. Is there anything you would have liked to do with the creature as far as other films would have gone? Like, I know Abbott Costello did Abbott Costello Meet Frankenstein with Bela Lugosi. Do you think something like that with the creature would have been a good idea? Something more comedic?
They were before my time. I didn't know any of them. And I had to be what I was. To create and be the last, I hope not forever, the last creature or horror film at Universal Studios. But I enjoyed my little film. It was 64 years ago. And for today, you know, 64 years, people are still interested in the show and still interested in buying pictures. So I'm having a great time.
Is there anything with the creature that you would have liked to do that you didn't get a chance to?
No, I was able to do anything I wanted. And, even underwater when we do any scenes, I would just do what I thought was right, and it turned out to be working well.
Tell me about the director.
We had a great director, and he did a lot of second unit work all over Hollywood and did a good job. However, we had a problem is he couldn't swim. So he would get in the inner tube and hang on to it and put a face mask on and look down underwater to see what we were doing or how we were doing it. And the problem was he couldn't be where we were because in seconds we'd be somewhere else. Scotty Welborn, the cameraman, pretty well directed all of the underwater scenes, as with my help, and we were able to accomplish whatever we needed for the film.
That's terrific. What does it feel like going down in history as one of the classic Universal monsters alongside Boris Karloff and Bela Lugosi, Frankenstein, Dracula?
It feels wonderful.
Cool. Well, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here, first of all. Thank you. This might seem like a completely trivial question, but what color was the actual suit you wore as the creature?
The suit was green.
Was it green? It was all green?
All green.
Because there's all the whole poster art.
Everything was green.
Okay.
There were no red lips.
No red lips. It's been a big bone of contention for people.
He has one color picture.
Yeah.
If you want to come over where we're at.
Okay.
He has one real color picture. A lot of them were colorized, but he has one that's an actual color picture.
So the didn't Life magazine or something do repaint the suit for color photos? One of their issues or something?
I'll tell you a funny story, though. We were going to get the cover of Life magazine with a boy riding a dolphin and holding on to the fin. So we went to New York, and they wanted to talk to us. And myself and Luke, the boy that was going to be in the movie, and Ivan were there. So they would take us into this room individually to ask us questions about the dolphin and about the scenes, because they didn't believe that we did it that way. The boy was really riding a dolphin because they'd never heard of it before. So they would question each one of us differently to find out if we were lying or whatever. And we were supposed to get the cover of Life magazine. But it turned out the Pope had died. And so the Pope got the cover and we got two or three pages in it. So we were happy with it.
Thank you.
Happier than Pope was.
Sorry. Just out of curiosity, how many different kinds of animals did you keep as pets at your house? You mentioned the frogs and the otters and everything.
How many different kinds of animals did you keep at your house and kind of train over your career?
Oh, I had all different kinds.
You had a bear.
Oh, wow. A pet bear. And the funny thing about the pet bear is he would try to climb up in the bed and sleep with us. And he would grab the covers, and as he was climbing, he'd put all the covers down. And you had to pull them back up, he'd pull them back down. Finally, you'd get in the bed and you'd go to sleep. So we enjoyed the bear, but when he got too big, we had to take him out and not use him in the house anymore. I had a pet skunk, and it was the cutest thing. But at night, they stayed awake, and he would go to the closet door and start scratching on it to open it, and he'd keep us all awake. So one night, he was scratching at the door and scratching here. My wife said, can you shut that animal up? So I got up and I picked him up and I walked out into the living room with him. I was going to put him in the kitchen and close the door so we wouldn't have to hear him. As we were walking through the living room, he bit me, he bit my finger, and I was shaking it because it was hurting. And I was shaking blood all over the floor, all over myself. And I got into the kitchen with him, and I turned in and started closing the door. Well, my wife got up. She was following me into the kitchen. She saw all this blood. She said, what did you do to that animal? I said, this animal got bit.
Did you, a lot of the animals that you worked with over the years, did you end up keeping them after filming as pets?
Yes. Yeah. I had one movie we did, Gentleman movie or a TV show, and we had a bunch of goats. So there were three very tame, nice goats. So I brought them home and released them in the backyard. I had a big house, and I had about 8 acres at that time. It was a lot of footage. So they would wander around eating everything. They ate everything. They'd eat all my wife's plants or orchids. So I had to get rid of them. So I called a guy in South Miami who had goats, and he came and picked them up and took them away. And when I had the otters, I had a cage built and a pool, and they would stay in there and swim. But they were so smart, when they come out, they would go to the door, and with their nose,